your local election headquarters.
Our panelist this morning, he's the Region 8 Director for the California Democratic Party. Good to have Humberto Gomez Jr. back on the program. Good to see you, sir.
Thank you very much for inviting me.
Thank you. And he's a familiar voice on News Talk 580, 105.9, KMJ. Philip Teresi back with us.
Thanks for having me back.
Well, thanks for coming back. I appreciate it. All right, so let's talk. There's a lot of Andrew Jans, Congressman Devin Nunes news to chew on this week. A lot of good juicy stuff for those of us who like getting into the weeds. And one of them was this Politico story that came out early in the week, where Andrew Jans basically said the DCCC, again, whose job it is to elect House Democrats, won't return his phone calls. What's going on with that, Humberto? He's frustrated.
Well, he's frustrated, but we also feel that the DCCC has, you know, throughout its past history, has kind of done the same thing. So what Andrew's trying to do is basically run as his own man. He's trying to run on the issues. He's trying to run as he's a public servant. He's been a public servant. Mm-hmm. And he's raising enough money, and he has a good team around him, and absolutely has the most amount of energy that I've ever seen to run someone that is running against definitely Congressman Nunes.
This is interesting because I know that here we go with TJ Cox, who's taking on David Valadao.
Yes.
Both did not do very well in the primary when you look at the head-to-head numbers, and I know that there were some other candidates in the Jans Nunes race, obviously.
Yes.
But we have TJ Cox, who's getting the visit from President Obama, gets Gavin Newsom to come through and do it. And so some people are going, wait, well, why are they supporting TJ Cox and not Andrew Jans?
Well, I think that it's really clear if you look at the different districts. And if Andrew Jans was running against Jim Costa, Andrew Jans would have the unbridled support of the DCCC. But he's not running against Jim Costa, he's running against Devin Nunes. And I'm sorry, but even the DCCC has said, Amanda Renteria said as much in the Politico article, the DCCC is about numbers. They're about data, mm-hmm. they're about math.
And we have some numbers we can actually put up on the screen. So guys, go ahead and throw that up if we have it.
Jans is not going to beat Nunes. Mm-hmm. Whereas with Cox and Valadao, it is a closer thing because Valadao's district is a purple district.
So here's for example, the primary results in 22. Andrew Jans with 32%. There were other Democrats in the race. They got, it was about 8.5%. I rounded it up to 9% for them. But still, that's a big gap. And when we compare that, when we say look at the Valadao-Cox primary, for example, it was, again, not great numbers for TJ Cox at the time. Do we have those guys? There it is, 37%. There was only two people in this primary, 63% for David Valadao. The bigger numbers that maybe you're talking about here are these numbers that we can put up, the other numbers in District 21, a district, by the way, that Hillary Clinton won by 15% in November of 2016. And that's also where Democrats outnumber GOP voters by 17%. So perhaps this is why the DCCC is not returning Andrew Jans' phone calls, because he's not in this district. He's in the other one with all the Republicans in it.
The one that Trump took by 10%.
The one that Trump took by 10%, but also what the DCCC never understands is they look at the numbers, but they don't have conversations with folks on the ground. When you see folks on the ground, when you see over 150 people precinct walking, when you see people going to underserved communities such as Orange Cove, and you see 25 to 30 people walking, when you see the amount of energy, when you see buses coming in from throughout the state of California, specifically because, of course, Devin Nunes has been on the national news. Okay, he's seen as being the person, and he said it in Washington, in Spokane, that his number one job is to protect President Trump. That's what he's there for. So it's that those statements do not have numbers, but the amount of energy and the amount of heart that I see people walking those particular precincts, that's what the DCCC doesn't know.
So they're messing up in your mind.
I believe they're making a huge mistake, but at the same time, DCCC has also, you know, kind of ignored in several ways when you had Amanda. They dropped out when basically 6 weeks from the finish line. So numbers do say something, but also, like I said, sometimes, you know, in this particular area, folks feel that the GCCC has been apathetic, and that's what I said.
Well, and those intangible metrics that you bring up are they are very relevant. The I think that the problem is the DCCC is looking at probably an unkind, but still the reality of the situation. You say that people are coming in on buses to participate in campaigning, and the light bulb that goes on in a conservative voter's head is they're not from around here. This is a this is a bunch of carpetbaggers coming in trying to unseat our guy. And that's going to have an effect on motivation to get out in November.
I know that there is a lot of people from within the district who are showing up in these protests, but I'm sure that there's still, to your point, there's probably lots of people outside of the district who want to see Andrew Janz win, who want to see Congressman Nunes no longer be in Washington, but they don't get a vote.
That's exactly it.
And the perception that, you know, Devin Nunes is not here. He's not doing his fundraisers. He's not raising money in the district.
Except that every time they go out to shoot video, they manage to catch Devin in profile and Mike DeManuel Jr. trudging through the bushes to come talk to him. Devin is in the district, and he is doing his job, and he is taking care of his constituents. I mean, I've got a half dozen stories from personal experience, not even work-related, where Devin has stepped up to take care of folks. And look, I think Andrew is a great prosecutor, and I think Andrew shows a lot of potential and a lot of promise. I think that he bit off more than he can chew, and the DCCC knows it.
Let me transition here, because you mentioned him as a prosecutor. And this past week, we saw a new campaign ad from the Nunes campaign criticizing Andrew Janz's Twitter use, saying that he's been tweeting hundreds of times during office hours. And we saw something this past week that I think shocked a lot of people, both Republicans and Democrats, and that was DA Lisa Smitkamp, his boss. Smitkamp, by the way, the name, big supporters of the congressman, stepping up in support of her employee, Andrew Janz, saying, listen, he's been doing a fantastic job keeping work here and the campaign here, and maybe also at the same time defending herself and the ship that she runs as boss as well.
I think from a perspective, anytime you attack the Smitkamps in terms of whether they have been highly successful family in terms of agribusiness, in terms of everything that they've done, in terms of a manager. And I've met with Lisa, and to me, that was like the biggest mistake they could have done.
So you saw that ad, and you saw it as an attack on a Smitkamp?
I seen that basically attacking her in terms because that she doesn't have a tight ship, that they're attacking her style of management, that, you know, basically, hey, you don't have a good quality assurance program right here. Just like in, and I'm like, look, that was the biggest mistake to me because Andrew, like I said, we might not feel that, you know, people in the district that I've talked to, they feel that Devin, you know, we have some disagreements in terms of that, but we feel that Devin hasn't done the job. And he's ignored the issues and that he's been there long enough. Right.
Well, about the point that you made, though, about this being an attack on a Smitkamp, is that reading between the lines that aren't there in your mind?
That's not how I took it at all. I see it as the Nunes campaign successfully pointing out that Andrew Janz is spending a tremendous amount of time. And if you're looking at the timestamps on the tweets, some time on the taxpayer dime working on his campaign. Now, do they have the time cards? I don't know. I don't think so. Do I think that Andrew Janz is neglecting his responsibilities? I don't think that Lisa Smitkamp would stand for it for a second. And I don't think that Devin Nunes would ever
suggest that.
She says
no. She says that he's been a fantastic prosecutor and still to this day.
And they requested that information because it's public.
She says that they've put it out there.
They put it out there. They requested it. The timestamps are there. He also, when he puts his tweets, he puts his initials if it came from him. So in terms of like the campaigns, in terms of him being a wonderful public servant, in terms of being in one of the toughest jobs, prosecuting, you know, horrendous crimes, definitely I think, you know what, Lisa runs a good ship.
Absolutely.
Lisa runs a good ship, and I just think that was not a good ad.
I also wondered how much of this is just, this is big time politics. Guys are going to throw haymakers. They're going to swing hard. And maybe sometimes those swings are a bit wild and other people get in the way and maybe take a bit of the punch. I mean,
well, and if the goal of the Nunes campaign was to put the image into the voter's mind of Andrew Janz with his feet up on the desk and his phone in his hand, they got that image out there. Now, Lisa's a good boss. All of us agree. Lisa's an amazing district attorney and she runs a tight ship. And I think that Andrew is an exceptional prosecutor. Again, I don't have anything bad to say about Andrew Janz, but if the goal is to chip away at the other person's credibility, Andrew Jans with his feet up on the desk playing with his phone when he's supposed to be working on cases is an easy image to conjure.
Here's the thing. We'll leave it at this because I got to go to break, but we'll leave it at this. They do the ads so that people could see the ads. They don't count on everybody reading up the follow-up articles in which so-and-so defends so-and-so. If you just, the ad's going to repeat and repeat and repeat and repeat. And that follow-up story, maybe that gets seen once. You know what I mean? Guys, hang tight. We've got a lot more to talk about. We're going to take a quick break. Coming up right after this, we're actually talking to Fresno's District 5 challenger, Paula Yang. She's taking on Councilman Luis Chavez. She joins me right after this.